world leaders meet in Glasgow to talk about the future of energy and how we're going to decarbonise, we're here in Wales where it's actually happening right now. In this video, we're going to look at a blueprint of future energy. Where are we, Gary?
We're in the Rhondda Valley, but what were they dragging out of that valley all those years ago?
Yeah, ironically, this is where a lot of the world's coal used to come from, particularly steam coal. They used to power ships, trains, and all sorts of generation. Yeah, now we've completely flipped it on its head. You'll notice behind us we see solar panels on the roof. The house behind us is jam-packed with low carbon technology, but it's really the brains behind it that we're going to look at today and how all this comes together to create a fantastic experience for the customers who are going to end up buying this home.
Okay, this is plot 26, so shall we cop a look at what's inside it, Gordon?
Take our shoes off and go in. So on the surface, this looks like any other two-bedroom home, apart from those solar panels on the roof that we saw, but it's actually packed full of the latest low-carbon technology that's set to become mainstream for how we build our houses in the future. So we're going to step through all those different elements to explain how they work together. But where are we going to start, Gary?
As we always do, let's start at the consumer unit.
Oh, eFIXX viewers love a consumer unit. And I think it's in this cupboard here. Ooh, what a treat. We're going to have to both go in here.
This isn't a consumer unit, and when I open it up, it's a three-phase distribution board, and for a two-bed house, that's pretty enormous and probably oversized, so let's think about it. It is a three-phase supply, and we'll see the thinking behind having a three-phase supply into this installation as we go through the tour. You'll notice down here we've got a surge protection device. Now, we could have done the risk assessment to say that maybe we didn't need a surge device. When you see the electronic equipment installed in this installation, for me, this is a must. These devices here are actually feeding up to the top board. So these feed out to here, of which we've got the panel split into two sides. So this left-hand side down here is what they call regulated. So that means we know the load. So we know the value of wattage of the immersion heater and the lights installed downstairs. So we actually know the value of these loads and we will measure those as well. This is the unregulated side, so in other words, we don't know the value of load, so on the socket outlet circuits, anything could be plugged in and obviously draw the load required for the item that's been plugged in. You also might notice on these ones here, the little red LED underneath. Yes, so here we've got the wireless AFDDs. And as we come down here, you might notice this RCD here for the solar PV, and look at the symbols we've got there. That makes this one a B-type RCD. So down here, we've got the metering, and we go into a deep dive with the metering. There is a standard three-phase kilowatt-hour meter at the origin of the installation, which we will look at, but they've also got the ability to split down to look at in greater detail what each element is using. So we've got the regulated and unregulated meters here. We've got these two here, which are the solar generation and the heat pump. So they're also measured as well for metering, and we come along here. We've got another RCD here. This RCD is for the three-phase EV charger. There you go, that's where that three-phase comes in, as well as the monitoring for the DC storage. So move away from the distribution board. It starts to get a little bit more technical, so I think it's time to pass it over to you, Gordon. That looks remarkably like, well, let's say it's a shoebox. We're in an understairs cupboard, aren't we?
Yeah, what else would you expect to find under the stairs but a shoebox? No, it hasn't got your flip-flops in it. This is a heat pump. And specifically on this project, it's a ground source heat pump, so more efficient than you get from those air source heat pumps that we see mentioned in the media a lot. But because obviously this is a new build, there's a lot of things the developer could do to get maximum efficiency. So these two pipes here are from our ground coil that is bored deep underground. There's a one that feeds a number of properties outside. That comes in here through the shoebox. So this is a 3 kilowatt heat pump. And then obviously we've got the flow and return pipework and another meter so that the exact performance of the heating system can be measured as well.
We're in the kitchen. This is in the fridge. I know I'm not a stranger to going to the fridge in the kitchen. This is our Sonnen batteries. We've got a 5 kilowatt hour here battery setup, and it's a hybrid. Okay, so what does that mean? It means it does both the inverting and the storage in here. So from the solar around the roof, we have our cables coming into a DC isolator in the roof space. It still brings DC down into our battery obviously to charge them, but obviously when we want to go out into the installation or to export it, goes through the inverter and is turned back into AC. So we know it will store the energy from our solar array, but it also brings in energy trading, doesn't it? In those off-peak times, we can store the energy in these batteries. If we're lucky enough, that energy might be at 1 or 2 pennies per kilowatt hour, or even we might be paid in order to charge the batteries within here. Let's think of the setup as well that we've got here. It's actually this height for a reason. The reason is we could slot another set of batteries in under here, making it a 10 kilowatt storage capacity. It's got a 50 mil gap here as expected, and at least half a meter gap here, allowing air to circulate through. And we know in previous generations of this style of battery setup, we had to have them maybe on an outside wall. Okay, we're not on an outside wall here. You can see how technology has changed. So we've got it fitted in here, inside of the kitchen, on an internal wall.
Regular viewers to the channel will know I love a cupboard, especially when it's got a central heating cylinder in, but this one is incredibly smart. This is the Mixergy Smart Cylinder, and it's got some great features. First of all, it's got our flow and return that come from the shoebox downstairs. When we're in water mode, that kicks up to a higher temperature to heat the water. Alternatively, we could use the excess energy from our solar PV panels, which is regulated into the cylinder itself. Now, this cylinder learns how much water is used and will only heat enough water to match the demand that's required by the homeowner. So it starts heating the tank top down, so it doesn't mix in with that cold water. And as we saw downstairs, there's even more metering in here to monitor the hot water consumption that will all feed into our model of this building that we're going to talk about a little bit later on.
To keep our plumber friends happy, upstairs we have got that traditional looking radiator. But what you might have realised during this tour is there is no gas in any of the houses on this estate. They're all using electricity in order to generate the heat. So the radiators upstairs working off that ground source heat pump are low heat radiators. We traditionally associate a ground source heat pump with underfloor heating, which they've got downstairs. So let's see how we control that heating upstairs.
That's enough plumbing talk, Gary. Let's get back to the world of wires and how this heating system is controlled. So upstairs, we've got a zone for the radiators. Downstairs, a separate zone for the underfloor heating, controlled by what looks like a normal thermostat, but this actually is pretty smart. The green LED there indicates the set point that you'll have set up in the home user app that we're going to look at in another video, because there's some great features with that. But once you've set your set point, you want to turn it up. Just again, look, we'll love it when an LED comes on, and again then down to decrease the temperature. So this goes through the control system that again we're going to look at a little bit further. They're not directly wired to the zone valves that you'd have in a normal heating system. And we're not just measuring temperature in this property here. This sensor here behind us is measuring the CO2 levels and also the humidity, so we can start to consider how healthy the environment is within this property.
How often do we see this? A new house being built with an EV charging point already being installed, and not just the facility to have one in the future. And this EV charging point is also three phase, meaning that two things: the customer can charge their car considerably quicker. In other words, they can plug it in and charge it at 22 kilowatts per hour. And also, when they can plug it in and leave it and then optimize the price in which they want to charge it at and take advantage of that excess green energy that's floating around on the grid.
Well, it's not just your car you can use to be clever with your energy consumption. What we've got here are smart appliances. So load up the washing machine in the morning, press the go button, but the actual time it starts will be determined by that optimum energy price, again, linked seamlessly into the control system that goes with this house.
We're back in the cupboard, almost where this journey started. And as we've walked around this property and seen all these smart connected items like the ground source heat pump, solar PV, DC storage, the smart heating system, the smart hot water tank, and the three-phase EV charging point, I'm thinking that's about 6 or 7 different apps for me to master.
I thought you were rounding off a through the keyhole there, Gary, for who would pull something together like this. Well, this project was pulled together by the Sero Group, who have done a fantastic job of integrating all this technology seamlessly together to work together, because you want that's the key to getting smart energy systems to work. But it relies on the brains in the box behind me that we can't even show you. It's that top secret. But again, it's all about reliability, and that reliability extends to the networking in there. There's the customer's Wi-Fi network that they use to obviously access that app, but the actual communication between here and the other systems is on its own dedicated network that not only stays in this house, it actually extends beyond the house to all of the houses on this development are seamlessly linked together to share their energy consumption and almost work in unison with the grids.
Well, that's fantastic, Gordon, but it's always the show home is absolute perfection, and that's always the first building they send you around, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. All that was missing in there was the smell of fresh coffee and bread. We're off now to go and find out more about how these properties were built, the wiring behind the plasterboard, to see what skills are needed to install it and get unlock some of the other secrets from the project team about how this project was delivered. But as ever, leave your comments below and we'll get back to as many as we can.